My topic today is basics in biostatistics. Now, why basics? Because without strong base, you cannot build a great building. So before we start, let me introduce myself. This is Dr. Atul Ginode. I'm working with RT Ayurved College, Akola, as an associate professor in Department of Research Methodology and Medical Statistics, and also associate professor and HOD in the Department of Agatantra. I am thankful to Dr. K.D. Chauhan sir, Registrar MUHS Nashik, Dr. Shrikant Deshmukh sir, who is Dean, Faculty of Ayurved MUHS Nashik, Dr. Pimparkar sir, who is Principal at RT Ayurved College, Akola, Dr. Jogolekar sir, who is Retired Professor at Tidak Ayurved College, Pune, Dr. Kulkarni madam, who is Coordinator, PG Studies, RT Ayurved College, Akola, and Mr. Ratnakar Kale sir and his team from IT Department, MUHS Nashik, for constant support, encouragement, and giving me this opportunity to interact with students on this very important topic. So what are the learning objectives of today's lecture? So at the end of this lecture, students will be able to understand what is mean by statistics, biostatistics, and medical statistics. Then what is mean by population? What are samples? And type, what is sample and types of sampling methods, then data, its types, sources of collection and presentation, then variability, probability, its types and laws of probability and variables. It is said that statistics is the art of never having to say you are wrong. To throw the light on significance of statistics, Lord Kelvin said, when you can measure what you are speaking about and express it in numbers, you know something about it. But when you cannot measure, you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of meager and unsatisfactory kind. So let's start our today's first point, that is statistics. So what is statistics? It is a branch of science which deals with the collection, presentation, analysis, and interpretation of numerical data. And what kind of numerical data? It is height, weight, temperature, blood pressure, blood sugar level, etc. So when the statistics is deal in public health or community health, it is called health statistics. When it deals in demography pertaining to vital events, it is called vital statistics. And when it deals with the medical, it comes under biostatistics. So what is biostatistics? It is the application of statistical methods, that is collection, classification, analysis, and interpretation to the data derived from the biological sciences like medical sciences. So it is called biostatistics. So medical statistics is a part of this broader science called biostatistics. Next point is population. What is population? The group of people of research interest under study at a particular time is called population. So at the level of clinical research, every individual with a certain disease or a risk factor is the population for medical science, as concerned to medical science. So what are the types of population? In terms of size, there are two types of population. First is finite and second one is infinite population. When you can count, it's called finite population, like students in the class, those of a medicine or duration of an illness. And second one is infinite population. When it is indefinitely large, then it is called infinite population, like world population. Then another type is in terms of composition, homogeneous population and heterogeneous population. When there is a little variation in the characteristic is called homogeneous population, like size of a tablet in the bottle. Then heterogeneous population, when there is a wide variation in the characteristics, It is, for example, individuals living in a town is called heterogeneous population. So when you will come across a statistical analysis, then you must know this term called parameter. It is in relation to population. So what is parameter? It is the measure of some characteristics of the population, like population mean and population standard deviation. It is true and unknown value we wish to estimate from the sample for the population. So this is all about population. Now next point is sample. So what is mean by sample? A finite subset of individual in the population which is selected for the purpose of investigation. See here, population is of two types, finite and infinite, but sample is always a finite, that is countable. Now what is mean by statistic? So it is the measure of some characteristics of the sample, that is mean, standard deviation, range, etc. It is called sample statistics or point estimate. So when you conduct any observational study or experimental study, we must know this term, that is sampling frame, sampling unit or observational unit. So when you perform any kind of survey study, then the list of houses is sampling frame, individual house is sampling unit, and house owner is our observational unit. So this is about sample. So here you can understand both the terms. This is entire population, and from that entire population we select our sample. Say for example, when we want to conduct a clinical trial, and we want to know the efficacy of any drug acting, say for example, AMWAT disease, then this target population is confirmed cases of AMWAT, and from those confirmed cases we select these samples. So this is population and sample. This is all about population and sample. Now next point is data. So any sort of information that can be collected, recorded, and analyzed is called data. So what kind of information it is? It is temperature, pulse, respiration, and blood pressure. Like this kind of information, when it is collected, recorded, and analyzed, it is called a data. Now, types of data. Based on source, there are two types of data. First, primary data and secondary data. So what is primary data? When the data that has been collected for the first time by an investigator, it is called primary data, like experiments. Then secondary data, it is existing data, also called existing data. So data which has already been collected for other purposes is called secondary data, like surveys and records. So based on sources, there are two types of data, primary and secondary. Now based on characteristic, there are again two types of data. First one is qualitative data and second one is quantitative data. So qualitative data, it relate to categories or attributes like religion, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, gender, like male, female, transgender, marital status, married, unmarried, divorced, widow, hair colors, like white color, gray color, black color, or blood group, like A, B, AB, or O. This is called qualitative data. Then second one is quantitative data. It results from measurement. It is numerical value, like height, weight, body mass index, serum level, etc. So these are the types of data. Now next point is sources of collection of data. So there are three main sources of collection of data: experiments, surveys, and records. So first one is experiments. So experiments are performed in the laboratories of clinical pathology, pharmacology, and the data generated is used in publication in scientific journals. So this is experiment which comes under primary data. Then second one is surveys. So surveys are carried out for the epidemiological studies in the community by the trained teams to find the status of disease or health condition like incidence of malaria or prevalence of leprosy. So these surveys are conducted through interviews and questionnaires. Surveys comes under secondary data. And last data is records. Records are maintained as a routine in a register over a long period of time for various purposes like population studies. The examples of records are census data, medical records, employment records, birth records, marriage records, mortality registers, etc. So these are the types and sources and collect sources data. Now next point is data presentation. So data presentation is nothing but presentation of data that is in systematic grouping. There are three types of in which we can present the data: was tabulation, mathematical representation, and graphical presentation. A famous British statistician Ronald Fisher said, "Proves nothing, but they bring outstanding effect to the eye." Now there are four types in tabular presentation or tabulation: simple cross table, table with this. Here diagrammatical presentation is used to represent qualitative data. Is used to represent quantitative data. Now in diagrammatical presentation, there are few types like bar diagram, which is again divided in three types: simple, multiple, and component. And bar diagrams can be presented in vertical form or horizontal form. Then pie or sector diagram, picture diagram or pictogram, map diagram, and Venn diagram. Then graphical presentation has again few types: histogram, frequency polygon, frequency curve, cumulative frequency curve, line chart, scatter or dot diagram, stem and leaf, and box and whisker plot. So let us see one by one. So tabular presentation is the most common method of data presentation of raw data in columns and rows. So this is the example of simple table. This is the example of cross table. This is the example of table with multivariables. And this is table prepared only for statistical analysis. This is called 2x2 contingency table, which is used in chi-square test of statistical analysis. Now we will see the types of diagrammatical presentation. So first one is bar diagram. It is a visual comparison of magnitude of different frequencies. Data on variable is represented on x-axis and frequencies on y-axis. Here you can see the same data is presented in vertical form and in horizontal form. It is the example of simple bar diagram. Here you can see multiple bar diagram. There are three bars you can see here. And this is a component type of bar diagram. You can see the compartments here. It is for zoology, botany, chemistry, and physics marks shown here in a compartment form. So this is all about bar diagram. Then next comes pie diagram. It is a particularly useful when the data is presented in percentage. Here whole circle is divided into many sectors equivalent to frequencies. You can see here the data is divided into many sectors. The categories represent total of 100%, and all categories are mutually exclusive. You can see some examples of pie diagram here. Now next comes pictograms. Small pictures or symbols are used to present a data in a pictogram. And this type of data presentation is for the common man to understand. Here you can see how the pictures, small pictures and symbols are used in this graphical presentation called diagrammatical presentation called pictogram. Now next comes map diagram. These types of diagrams are prepared to show the geographical distribution of frequencies. Here a mark of point denotes the occurrence of event. You can see here the marks on all charts. So this is a map diagram. Now next comes Venn diagram. Venn diagrams is used to represent the relationship between two groups. You can see here the players who plays only cricket are Rohan, Ram, Shyam, Mohan and Suresh, and the players who plays only hockey are Naresh, Mahesh, Leela and Sunita. But Ramesh is the only player who plays cricket and as well as hockey also. So it shows degree of overlap and exclusivity. So this is Venn diagram. Now we will see graphical presentation. So first in graphical presentation is histogram. So when continuous quantitative data is to be presented, usual bars are drawn adjoining to each other. You can see here the bars are drawn adjoining to each other. Thus, area under each bar represents the proportional probability, the proportional probability of that class interval. So this is the example of histograms. Now frequency polygon. It is nothing but frequency distribution. It is obtained by joining the upper midpoints of histogram blocks by a straight line. You can see here the upper midpoints of histogram blocks are here joined by a straight line, and the data is represented in the form of their curve. Is represented in the form of curve. So this is frequency polygon. Then comes frequency curve. It is obtained by joining the upper midpoints of histogram blocks by a smooth line. We saw here in previous slide that in frequency polygon, this histogram blocks are joined by straight line, but here in frequency curve, these histogram blocks are joined by a smooth line. Here you can see the blocks are joined here by a smooth line. So number of observations are large, which are reduced to group intervals in a small. So in this type of frequency curve, we get a curve like bell shape. So this is about frequency curve. And next comes cumulative frequency curve. It is also called ogive curve. Cumulative frequencies are obtained by adding the frequencies of each variable, and it is the graphical representation of cumulative frequency distribution. Here you can see this is a less than ogive curve and this is a more than ogive curve. So this is about ogive curve or cumulative frequency curve. Now next is line chart. This is a simple type of diagram which is useful in studying the changes of variables with the passage of time. Here in line diagram, it is essential to show zero on this y-axis. You can see here the zero is mentioned on the y-axis. So it shows trend with the passage of time. Here you can see a trend with the passage of time. This is about line chart. Then comes scatter or dot diagram. To know the relationship between more than one variable of same unit, the scatter or dot diagram is used. It is used to represent the two variables simultaneously. In first diagram, you can see Here it is shown a positive relationship between the two variables. Then in second diagram, there is a negative correlation between the two variables shown. And in third diagram, there is a no correlation between the independent variable on x-axis and dependent variable on y-axis. So this is scatter or dot diagram. Then comes stem and leaf plot. These are the special tables where each value is split into stem, the first digit, and the leaf, the last digit. It helps to find out mean, median, mode, and range. You can see here in stem and leaf plot, this is the key is shown here. The key shows how to read the diagram. 2 and 5. 2 is stem and 5 is leaf. So it means 25. 6 is recorded as 0 and 6. This is 1, 3 means 13. 2, 5 means 25. 3, 6 means 36. 4, 5 means 45. And 5, 0 means 50. So this is all about stem and leaf plot. Then next is box and whisker plot. It is used for very large data set and it displays the 5 number summary of a set of a data. Here you can see it. First one is minimum, that is lower extreme. Then first quartile is lower quartile. Then median, then upper quartile is third quartile. And then maximum is upper extreme. So this is about box and whisker plot. Now, next point is variability. It is very important in concern with biostatistics or statistics. Variability is nothing but the variations observed from person to person or from group to group in various physical, mental, or other characters. It is a natural biological phenomenon, and no two measurements or two characters are absolutely equal in two persons. Here you can see here. The images shown here are self-explanatory to this title, that is variability. So there are three types of variability: biological variability, real variability, and experimental variability. So first we will see what is biological variability. So it is the difference of the individuals of the same environment in various attributes like age, sex, height, you can see here the difference in heights, weight, then color of eyes, you can see here the difference in color of eyes, and other characters like other characters. So there are four types of biological variation: individual variation, periodical variation, class or group variation, and sampling variation. So we will see one by one. What is mean by individual variation? So variability studied among individuals is called individual variability. Height of two individuals of the same age. You can see here in this image, this is called individual variability. Then periodical variability, measuring vitals like temperature, pulse, respiration, and blood pressure repeatedly at different times of the day gives different results, is called periodical variability. The next one is class or group variability. So variability studied among groups, classes, is of the society is called class or group variability. And last one is sampling. When different samples study shows variability from sample to sample, it's called sampling variability. Now, what is sample? We already saw in previous slides, sample means a subset unit of the population. Now, next one is real variability. When the difference two observations of sample is more than the defined limits in the universe, then it is called real variability. For example, of people's suffering than Nagpur or Kolhapur or Solapur. So this is called real variability. Here the cause is not natural, but due to some external factors like geographical condition, environmental factor, or pollution. So this is called real variability. The last type of variability is experimental variability. When the differences is due to materials, procedures, or techniques involved in the experiment is called experimental variability. There are again three types of experimental variability: observer error, instrumental error, and sampling error. And observer error have again two types: subjective and objective. So what is subjective error? By untrained interviewer while noting human particulars like socio-economic status, whether the person belong to poor class, middle class, upper middle class, rich class, like. So this is subjective error. Then objective error, by untrained observer while recording human measurements like height. Then next come instrumental error, using defective apparatus like weighing machine, sphygmomanometer, or other. It's called instrumental error. Observer error and instrumental error are sometimes called as non-sampling error. Last type of experimental variability is sampling error. Sample selected is not representative of that population, then it is biased, and when is collected in small numbers in size, it is called sampling error. So this is all about variability. Now the next and most important topic of statistics is probability. What is meant by probability? It is the measure that describes the chance or likelihood that an event will occur. As we all know that an uncertainty is associated with every conclusion, and this uncertainty is numerically expressed as probability. It is the theory that allows us to make an inference from sample statistic to a population parameter. Now, what is sample statistic and what is population parameter? We already saw in population and sample slides. So, tossing the coin, we get head or tail. So, this is the probable outcome from this tossing the coin. Then when we roll a dice, we get any number from 1 to 6, and picking up a desired or favorable color from the marble is also comes under the probability theory. So what is the application of probability? It helps to interpret statistical results, and it is helpful in making prediction in studies with uncertainty. Now we will see the types of probability. There are three types of probability: subjective probability, then empirical, statistical, or relative frequency probability, and classical, priori, or theoretical probability. So first is subjective probability, the estimation of probability by making an educated guess or by intuition is called subjective probability. Like, for example, probability that new product or new medicine will be successful is called subjective probability. Then empirical probability, the frequency of outcome is measured by experimentation or historical data is called empirical probability. Like, for example, probability that it will rain today is 60%. It is drawn here from this historical data. This is called empirical probability. The last type of probability is classical probability. The number of outcome in the sample space is known and each outcome is equally likely to occur is called classical probability. See here, from picking a card from a deck, you want ace only, then the probability is 4/52. Or if you want only heart ace, then it is 1/13. So it is 7.69. So when the outcome is fixed, it is called classical type of probability. Now next point is laws of probability. There are three laws of probability: addition law, multiplication law, and binomial law. Addition law: one event excludes the probability of occurrence of other event. The two events are called mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive events means cannot occur at the same time. Say, for example, in one throw of a dice, getting 4 excludes other 5, that is 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6 events. Like dying excludes survival. And here in this example show male surgeon and female surgeon. So mutually exclusive events follows the addition law of probability. The word or is there when addition law is applicable or applied, like the in a clinical trial when you are studying the experimental drug is will cure or relieve or have no effect or on the disease under study. So this is the addition law of probability. Then second one is multiplication law of probability. When two or more events occurring together but not associated with each other or independent from each other, then it is called multiplication law of probability. For example, two coins tossed together at the same time will land heads up. Here you can see the word and is there when multiplication law is applied. Like say, sex of a child here is male or female, and the RH factor is RH positive or RH negative. These two events are occurring together but not associated with each other. That is, the male child will be RH positive or RH negative, or female child will be RH positive or RH negative. This is called multiplication law of probability. Last type of probability is binomial law. It is used when events are occurring one after other. For example, childbirth by gender in a hospital. You can see here, the first child born is male or female and the second child is desired, then what will be the possible sequence is shown by this binomial law of probability. So this is all about probability. Now we will see the probability scale. The lowest value on probability scale is 0 and the largest value is 1. And the probabilities are written as fraction, decimal, or percentage on probability scale. So an event with a probability of 0 will never happen, like rolling two dice simultaneously and getting 14 is impossible. That is 0 probability. Then half, an event with a probability of half is as like to happen as not to happen. That is 50-50 chance. When tossing the coin and getting heads or tails, this comes under this even chance probability. And lastly, an event with a probability of 1 is certain to happen. That is, the sun will rise. So this is all about probability and probability types, laws, and probability scale. Now we will move to the next point. That is types of sampling methods. So there are two main types of sampling method. First one is probability sampling and second one is non-probability sampling. So there are again 5 types in probability sampling: simple random, systematic, stratified, cluster, and multi-stage sampling. And in non-probability sampling, convenience, quota, judgment or purposive, and snowball sampling. Now we will see one by one. So first one is simple random sampling. It is the most common method of sampling, and this method is applicable when population is small, homogeneous, and readily available. For example, patients coming to the hospital. And importance of simple random sampling is every subject has an equal chance. This is most important word, equal chance of being selected in the study. So this type of sampling is also called equal probability sampling method or unrestricted random sampling. So how this simple random sampling is done? By random number table, lottery method, throwing of dice, tossing of coins, blindfolded method, and sieve method. So it is used in experimental studies for testing the efficacy of particular drug. So this is about small simple random sampling. So this is how from the target population the samples are selected randomly. Here you can see same also. So this is called simple random sampling. Now next one is systematic random sampling. This method is used when complete list of population is available. The method is applicable when population is large, scattered, and not homogeneous, that is heterogeneous. Here individuals are selected at regular interval from the sampling frame, and it is useful in the field survey, household survey, patient clinic, and old records. Here selection of the first number must be from random sampling, and then the systematic random sampling must be applied to other samples. So this is all about systematic random sampling. Now next is stratified random sampling. Strata means non-overlapping groups. This method is applicable when population is not homogeneous, that is population is heterogeneous. So the population under study is first divided into homogeneous groups or classes called strata, and then the sample is drawn from each stratum at random. There are two types of stratified random sampling. First one is proportionate and second one is disproportionate. So in proportionate sampling, it is in proportion to size of each stratum, and in disproportionate, the samples are not selected in proportion to size of stratum. Now the proportionate sample gives more accuracy in the results than disproportionate one, and it gives representation to all the strata like age, gender, socioeconomic class, area under study of the society. This is how the stratified random sampling is done. So this is our target population, and from this target population we first divided this heterogeneous population into homogeneous one. So this is say for age strata, this is say gender strata, this is say socioeconomic strata, and from this different strata we select the samples randomly. So this is stratified random sampling. Now next one is cluster sampling. Here cluster means natural groups. Cluster is randomly selected groups. This method is used when unit of populations are clusters like village, children of school, blocks of town, factories, etc. In this method, clusters are selected randomly instead of individual samples. Now you see here this village is divided into 5 clusters: is cluster 1, cluster 2, cluster 3, cluster 4 and cluster 5. And out of this 5 cluster, these two clusters are selected randomly for the study. So this is all about cluster sampling. Now next is multi-stage sampling. Here the samples are selected at several stages. So it is called multi-stage sampling, like a large country survey, for example, a hookworm survey in a district. So here the random numbers of districts are chosen in all the states, followed by random numbers of taluka, villages and units respectively. So it is called multi-stage sampling. One more type is there, that is multi-phase sampling. Here in this method, the part of the information is collected from whole sample and part from the subsample. Like in tuberculosis survey, the physical examination and Montauk test is done in all cases in phase 1. Then in phase 2, Montauk test positive cases, in Montauk test positive cases, chest x-ray is done. And in phase 3, chest x-ray positive cases, sputum examination is done. And this is how the sampling is done in multi-phase sampling. Now remember one thing, every sampling method has some advantages and disadvantages. So keeping in mind this thing, we should select appropriate method of sampling as per our study design or study type. So here ends the types of probability sampling. Now we will see the types of non-probability sampling. So first one is convenience sampling. Researcher select those units from the population which are easily accessible and easy to recruit. Here you can see this researcher has selected these green colored figures and blue colored figures which are easily accessible and easy to recruit, but he has not selected these purple figures in his sample. So this is called convenience sampling. It relies on available subjects for inclusion in the sample. For example, recruiting patients in a hospital is called convenience sampling. Now next one is quota sampling. Here study subjects are selected on the basis of some fixed quota, for example, in scholarship schemes of government. Now quota sampling is similar to stratified random sampling, except it does not provide an equal chance to all the elements in the population for being selected. So this is the difference between quota sampling and stratified random sampling. So what types of quota are there? Age, gender, socioeconomic status, income, occupation, education, religion, geographical region, etc. Here you can see in this diagram or in this image that here the quota is selected from this population, the quota is selected of male and above 50 years. So this is all about quota sampling. Then next is purposive, that is judgmental sampling. Here subjects are chosen as per the nature of the study population and a specific purpose of the study. And it is used when sample size is small and simple random sampling may not select the most appropriate study subject. Then this is applied. You can see here from this population, only highly qualified persons are selected for the study. So this is all about purposive or judgmental sampling. And last type of non-probability sampling is snowball sampling. Here existing subjects recruit future subjects like rolling snowball. So it is also called a chain sampling, and it is used for sensitive and difficult to access population like drug users or commercial prostitutes. Here you can see the existing subject recruiting the future subjects. So about non-probability sampling, there is no randomness in non-probability sampling, and study units are selected deliberately. So non-probability sampling is not an usual approach or choice in sampling. So this is all about sampling. Now, this is the last topic of our today's lecture, that is variable. What is variable? It is the characteristic or attribute that is to be measured, and it varies from person to person and from time to time. It's called variables. Now, there are four types of variable: independent variable, dependent variable, confounding variable, and demographic or universal variable. So first we will see dependent variable, and then we will see the remaining. Dependent variable, a variable that is dependent on the independent variable, the outcome of an experiment. What is independent variable? It is the variable that is being manipulated and measured in an experiment in order to observe the effect of a dependent variable. It is also called causal or exposure variable. What is confounding variable? It is independent variable that are not related to the purpose of the study, but may affect the dependent variable. And how it affects? It strengthens or it weakens the relationship between the dependent and independent variable. Now, see one example. Studying the association between low birth weight babies and parity. Here, the dependent variable is low birth weight babies, and independent variable is parity. And here, confounding variable is age of mother. And last type of variable is demographic or universal variable. Here, demographic or universal variable means age, gender, socioeconomic status, marital status, occupation, etc. These are called universal or demographic variables, which does not change. You can understand these variables from this simple diagram. See, low birth weight babies, the dependent variable. Parity here is independent variable, that is cause, exposure. And age of mother is a confounding variable. Independent variable and dependent variable also. Now, this slide is specially for students. So, relationship between variables. If students missing the most classes get lower grades, the suggestion is that there is a causal relationship between attendance and overall performance. So, my message is, you might have bumped the classes in 2019, but please don't bump the classes in 2020. My take home message is, ekam shastram adhyano na vidyat shastra nischayam tasmat bahushrutah shastram vijaniyat chikitsakah. Is well said by Sushruta. Main yahan par bhagwan dhanvantari ko pranam karta hu, आचार्य सुश्रुत और आचार्य डल्लन को प्रणाम करता हूं, और एक छोटा सा करेक्शन और हम कहेंगे कि एडिशन इस श्लोक में करता हूं कि एकम शास्त्रम अधियानो न विद्यात शास्त्र निश्चयम तस्मात बहुश्रुतः शास्त्रम विजानियात चिकित्सकः एंड विजानियात संशोधकः। अगर आप एक बहुत अच्छे चिकित्सक बनना चाहते हैं और अगर आप एक बहुत अच्छे संशोधक भी बनना चाहते हैं, रिसर्चर बनना चाहते हैं, तो मैं आप सभी से यही गुजारिश करूंगा कि यूनिवर्सिटी इज टेकिंग ग्रेट एफर्ट्स फॉर यू पीपल ओनली, सो रीड एज मेनी एज पॉसिबल बुक्स एट होम, दिस इज शोन हियर, सो स्टे होम, स्टे सेफ एंड कीप लर्निंग। सो थैंक यू वन एंड ऑल। सो दिस इज ऑल अबाउट द बेसिक्स इन स्टैटिस्टिक्स। This is my contact number, WhatsApp number, and this is my email ID. If you have any queries, you can call me or send me email anytime. and you will be answered within 24 hours. Thank you and have a good day.